Okay. Welcome. How are we doing today? All right. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 13. I think we have one person missing. We will shame them.
When we figure out who they are.
Yeah. Who is it? Oh, it's Josh. It is Josh. Josh, where are you, man?
He's usually a few minutes late.
He's probably coming. So, welcome to yet another edition of Robotics and Automation. I'm really happy that Barack Obama popularized the pause mid-sentence because, let me tell you, I love the pause mid-sentence. So, we are seminaring again this week, and I hope you guys, so we've got project stuff to do, and we're going to save that for the latter half. We're going to seminar quicker today, though, because we have a lot of project stuff to talk about. So I'm hoping that the seminar can be about an hour, and then we'll spend the rest of the time doing project stuff. How does that sound? Cool. All right. So, that is not this course. Let's look at notes. We are on week 3 of the seminar. You guys should have all either already or very soon be submitting your response papers to the reading. I didn't send you guys out any extra papers to read this week, mostly because I haven't had power for 4 days. I'm going to blame everything on that. But yeah, so we'll see. I still think that, so what you guys have been doing when there is not, you know, as we discussed before, if there's no extra paper to respond to, then you have to find some source material yourself and respond to it. So you could pick any topic that you're interested in, do some research on it, and then write the research paper about that. So 2 pages of summary, at least 1 page of research write-up. And you can go longer, it's fine. Although I would caution you from going super long, mostly because I believe that sometimes making something short is more valuable than making something long, because it makes you organize and prioritize your ideas a little bit better. So, something to think about. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to talk about is representation. And we're not going to talk a lot about it, but I'm just going to go through, like last time, sort of hit on some bullet points that I got out of the reading, I guess. So representation is the form in which information is stored or encoded in the robot. Memory is the device in which information is stored. A world model is a representation of a robot's environment. The paradigmatic example is, of course, a map. So, I think we've talked a little bit tangentially about simultaneous location and mapping, SLAM. That's a world model is being created by that process, right? So you're simultaneously trying to figure out where you are and map out your environment. So, next, robots can represent information about self, environment, actions, the effect of its own and others, and tasks. Okay, so it needs to have a representation of these things. It depends. I mean, so you might have like a state model of itself. That might be something that it has. If it's a very, we're going to get to deliberative control. If it's a very deliberatively controlled robot, then it likely does have a dynamic model of itself and can run a simulation of what it can do and how it can go from this state to another state. But there are some issues with that that we'll talk about. Robots can represent information. Representation has computational and memory costs, as you can imagine. Having a fully three-dimensional model of the environment and of itself and a dynamic model of it with physics and all of that stuff is going to take a lot of memory and also processing to decide what to do and what the most optimal choice is. So I think the book did a pretty good job of presenting the reality that we're always fighting against, that state spaces grow really quickly. And that's kind of the fundamental problem that we have with deliberatively coming up with a plan, is that there are so many possible states that you could be in, and it takes a lot of computation and storage to go through all that. If we had infinitely fast processing and infinite storage, not a problem. You can just do all of that, but we don't have that. Also, when you're on a robot, you hardly even have, you don't have access to supercomputing power, for instance, typically, because if you've got one that's connected to a supercomputer wirelessly, then that's possible. A lot of times, I would consider that to be a robot still, but there's a sort of...
what if that supercomputer is powering many, many robots?
Right. And so...
Are you counting them all as one robot?
Yeah. I think that the question becomes, what is a robot? And if it needs somebody else to make its decisions for it, is it autonomous anymore? I don't know. I'm okay with that as being a robot, but other people will be like, you're cheating, you can't do that. Most robots, though, these days have all the computing power is happening on board, which gives you, adds not just processing limitations and storage limitations, but it also adds power limitations as well. So just because you can process a certain amount of information doesn't mean you want to do that all the time, because your power source, your battery, is not going to last very long. I don't know if you've ever run a simulation on your laptop before, not plugged in.
30 minutes later.
Yeah, the battery pretty much drains steadily, and it's because you're sucking a lot of energy to do all those cycles.
Only if it's hard work
accelerated. And there's, it's usually nice and quiet, but then when I run a simulation for a while, actually, it's when I process these videos, that's when it uses up all the cores, practically. I think it leaves, one for other tasks. And it just, and the fan turns on, and the battery just, so you don't want to be processing like that, even if you have the power to do it, because our batteries are limited, too. So a lot of issues with doing that type of thing. But that's what we're going to talk about here, is deliberative control. So planning is the process of determining possible outcomes of actions and searching for the best sequence of actions to achieve a goal. And so that's a big bag of worms, okay? Let's just take a moment to reflect on how big of a bag of worms this is, because possible outcomes of actions and searching for the best sequence of actions to achieve a goal. Now, that is assuming a lot of things. For instance, you know what the result of an action is going to be. You have to know that with pretty high confidence to have any hope of planning, right? Unless we're going to be defeatist about it and use the maxim that plans are useless, but planning is essential, which I think a general said once. I'm not sure which one, but I always like that quote. we have to have some idea of what our actions will result in. And if that, so you have to have a pretty good model of the environment. You have to have a pretty good model of yourself. If anything changes in the environment, you have to be able to recognize that. So there's a lot that you need to be able to know. It's asking a lot to be able to make a plan to achieve something and go execute it. Also, you have to assume that while you're executing the plan, nothing changes, right? So like you could come up with a great plan and then an object moves and then it's like suddenly is not a great plan anymore. There's a better plan if you could stop and recompute. So and you can kind of see this a little bit, what's happening in your Google Maps. Like when you take a wrong turn, or even when you don't, but it thinks you did, it's like, like recalculating what the best route is and comes up with a new route. You took a wrong turn or whatever. Maybe there was construction. You couldn't go that way. You didn't know you couldn't go that way. And so that happens. And so it's a hard problem. It's not that we should never try, but it is not simple to do planning. But it is our best chance of having something optimal too. So it's our best chance of getting something that acts completely optimally, which in some sense, we think of something that behaves intelligently as something that does things with economy, right? It does it without a lot of extra effort that didn't need to be done. So planning is something that we should be able to do at least somewhat if we want to have some sort of intelligent machine. But it is difficult. So search is used in planning to find one or more paths to the goal state in the representation. So I had a student working on artificial intelligence directed study with me last semester, or the semester before, I can't remember, last semester. And he identified this problem that he spent quite a bit of time working on, and that was to try to optimize the path that a robot takes from one point in the field to another point in the field with a bunch of obstacles in it. And he was using a search algorithm, an AI search algorithm for it. So the idea is, at each stage you have several different possible moves that could be along the optimal path. The shapes in this case were polygons. And so what's nice about that is that your optimal path, if you have polygons in there, is going to be along the edges of polygons. So it limits the number of possible moves without giving you an infinite number of possibilities. So it's kind of like it's a good start at an optimization sort of problem for navigation. So you want to have the optimal path from point A to point B through these obstacles. And you want it to be able to, if it knows where the obstacles are, so it has a map, you want it to be able to decide which path to go on. So the first question is I'm not on the edge of a polygon, but I know that I need to get to the edge of a polygon, so which polygon do I go to? Then you have to decide which way around the polygon should I go, and at what point should I leave this polygon and go to another polygon to find my path. And even I don't remember how many objects he put in, like four polygons in there. And even with that, like, I don't remember how big his state space was, but it was large. It gets large very quickly because, so if you think about it, in the first move, he might have like five possible moves, say. But in the next one, he's got five possible moves. And then the next one, he's got five possible moves. And so every time you pick a move, you have more possibilities than that one. So you could also have gone the other way and there were possibilities there too. So if you keep adding on, so it's move one, move two, move three, move four, you have, I mean, easily can become this intractable problem if you're just going to calculate everything. So that's one thing you could do. You could calculate every possible move, right? Just every possible five-step move, every possible six-step move, every possible seven-step move. And once you find the end, then you can say, okay, well, this is the optimal one. But unfortunately, that is almost intractable already. Like, even with a simple problem like this, like, it's processing, representation, all of that stuff is almost too much processing to do it in any finite amount of time. So they come up with these search algorithms where you say, okay, based on some metric, is this move that I made here, is this better? Have I gotten to a better place than I made this move, or was it worse? Now, this isn't a guarantee that this is a good path, but maybe it's better. So by some metric, like, for instance, distance to the end goal, that might be a metric. So if that metric is being, so what you could do, they're like breadth first and depth first searches, but it's this big tree of possibilities. And so what you want to do is just sort of choose the ones that seem most promising and explore those areas first. And that's most likely to get you a good solution. Yeah.
Would that be like probabilistic? So you're going, like, if I go left, there's a 75% chance I'll get to the end quicker. And if I go right, it's a 25% chance. Or is that?
Yeah, I mean, you can possibly interpret it in that way, but you don't necessarily know what those probabilities are.
Right.
What you're trying to do is say, okay, I don't want to compute all possible solutions because I can't for most problems. So how can I come up with what's a pretty good solution from what I know, from my some sort of metric? Like, okay, getting towards this goal has got to be a good thing. Like, maybe you have an environment where heading straight towards where you want to go is actually not the best way. I mean, it might be that you have a dead end that way, and you have to come all the way back out and go around. But so it doesn't. So you can end up with difficult problems to solve with these algorithms, and they don't always work very well. But the idea is you can get there quickly, and you don't have to compute everything. By using these AI methods, yeah.
Does that end up becoming iterative? So you do it once and say, no, it didn't work very well. And then you send it, because it's repeating.
You can.
So then it's picking up, okay, this worked well, this didn't work well, and then it's refining its matrix as it's going around.
Yeah, so you can have it, so if it can find one solution, so one path from A to B, what you could do is maybe say, okay, this path works, but is there a better path? And just try deviations from that path. See if you can make one that's shorter. That's one way to go with it. There are a lot of different methods, but they're essentially, they come down to searching. You're just searching for a good solution, and the manner in which you search is an algorithm that's developed, these AI algorithms, and they help you make a good choice as far as what your next move is. So those are, I mean, there are lots of them. I mean, that was just like kind of one example that I gave, but they pretty much all come down to wanting to come up with the best path to the goal, and how to find solutions that are pretty good without having to compute every one. So. So that's like optimizing search, and we want them to be optimal, but it isn't always going to be the most optimal that we require. Sometimes it's just whatever is good enough, but that I can compute quickly. That often is the best option. So, and that concept is going to come up a lot today, that concept of, can we get a good enough idea to make a decision right now. We represent the environment, the goal, and the robot as a set of states. And so these sets of states, I mean, I think that in the reading, it was like the vacuum problem. It had, is it in this book that there's a vacuum problem?
Toto.
Sir?
Toto.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. So there's another example where really, really simple problem. This is in an AI book, I think. Where your robot is a vacuum cleaner robot, and it has very simple logic. If it's in a room and it's dirty, then clean it. If it's in a room and it's clean, move to the other room. And that's the whole algorithm. And that's really simple. You can have either the vacuum cleaner on or off. And you can have it move states. So, and then the environment can either be clean or dirty. So there's like not even a ton of possibilities there, but you can list out the state space for that, and it still does like, I don't know how many possibilities, like 20 something possible states that you could be in with two rooms or three rooms, and maybe it's three rooms and those two states. So a robot could be in room one, two, or three, could be on or off, and the room could be clean or dirty. And like you look at the table, it's already this big. And so you can imagine when you have more possibilities for each thing, the possible states that your system could be in is huge. So, large state spaces are difficult to search, especially in real time. And that's kind of the big problem with deliberative control. So time scale, spaces are too large, state spaces are too large, computation's too slow. Memory, also some drawbacks there. The state space representation requires significant storage, don't always have enough. And information, sometimes information is outdated. So like we talked about, an obstacle could have moved, what do you do? And then execution. Sometimes it's difficult to execute a plan. So you've got, I mean, now you've got a plan, you got to execute it. Well, you might think that you can go from here to that to there in a straight line, but actually there's something you couldn't see, and you have to change your plan. So it just makes it difficult. It's not something you can't overcome, but it makes it difficult. So deliberative control is of limited use in robotics right now. This type of thinking is still used a lot in other applications, though. So in applications that don't have time restrictions, that are static environments, and some folks who use non-robotics AI. So AI that is not in a robot uses this a lot, these sorts of ideas a lot, where we have a state space, let's search it.
Like playing chess.
I mean, that's part of why the AI researchers get mad when they say it's like a moving target, right? Because they say, oh, well, if you could teach a computer to beat a human at chess, then, like, you know, we have some AI there. And then we were like, nah, it doesn't really seem like AI, because you know what you did is you just computed all the possibilities and then just chose the moves that were the best moves, and then you can beat somebody. Like, that's not really intelligence, that's something else. And so then, like, maybe if you could beat somebody at Go, which requires all this intuition, and recently AI has started to beat the world champions at Go.
It was just earlier this year.
Yeah, so...
Last year.
Yeah, so that's, like, now the thing. Really?
Oh, yeah.
Which included what?
Wow.
Wait, the machine blood?
Yes.
Oh. Yeah, it picks up on the other player's habits.
Interesting. Yeah.
Source?
Right. Yeah.
Put it on your phone.
Put it on your Google Glass. That would be funny. I mean, I'm sure that the casinos are really worried about this. Like, I'm sure they're really worried that there are people who just sit there and just... It just if they had some way to input what cards are on the table and what they have to compute what the best move is, I bet they're really worried about it. They probably already have, like, consultants that they meet with to try to figure out how to
get... Because the number one money bringer in a casino is roulette.
Oh, yeah.
You can't really predict roulette.
Yeah.
Unless the table's flawed.
Yeah. Yeah, I think...
The second highest hole is Texas Hold'em. Players against each other, so... doesn't matter who wins.
Right.
Casino takes their cut.
Yeah, the professional poker players, I mean, they go and they play suckers who are in town who just want to go play some Texas Hold'em or whatever, and they just make a lot of money playing against them. I mean, they're usually not playing other professionals. I mean, that's not a good way to go about it if you're doing that. I've known a couple of professional poker players, and it's a weird job. But there's one guy who he was a professional poker player for like 5 years, and then he retired. And he's like 35 now. And he and his girlfriend took a Volkswagen van and did the whole thing for making it into a travel bus for them, and they took a trip around the country for a year. And yeah, I don't know. It's kind of weird. I don't know. Professional poker players, I guess it's quite a lifestyle, but no. I don't know if I could do it. Okay, so seminar seeds. So if this type of control is so computationally intensive, how do humans do it? Or do we do it? You probably don't do it.
I don't ever find myself competing with all the else.
I think we might do it in certain situations. And I think the same sort of thing happens to us when we do it. Like, it's tiring, right? For example, we're coding something, we have to pretty much map out everything that we think is going to happen and code it for the right outcome. And then as far as when I do it, get really tired doing it, right?
I think we consolidate a lot of information and start to make approximations.
Humans are also really good at pattern recognition, so if you've encountered the problem before, you know how to tackle it.
Mm-hmm.
I think civil engineers have a good example for this. When we design buildings, we have different ways of combining the loads for earthquake, wind, rain, and whatever. And we always use the max one. So when you're starting out, I don't know which one, just looking at a building, will be most predominant. But after a while, a lot of engineers just know, equation set 4, and then just go for it.
Hmm.
So,
but we also don't ever really consider all possibilities. We find some major ones that we recognize through patterns or through whatever, and then we attack those. And then, for the most part, that's where you get into where your testing phase, the smaller stuff starts coming through. It's I didn't think of that.
Mm-hmm.
We don't really plan for everything. We plan for major strokes, and then as it continues, find that later.
Yeah. I think that for me, when I think about this, I think about athletes. And they can do some incredible things that are really hard to compute or to program a robot to do. And if you've ever done something when I played baseball, I would do this thing just messing around where I was walking with a baseball in my hand, I would just toss it up and I would catch it behind my back as I was walking. And it's hard to do, but it's not as hard as it seems like it would be to do. Yeah, I probably, I did it a few times. I mean, sure, you're going to practice it, but if it takes more than, 50 times to do it, I mean, at least for me, I wasn't motivated to do it after that. So I was able to have a pretty good sense when I let that ball go, where it was going. My body is moving forward. I was walking. I had a sense of where I put my hand to catch it. And what's interesting is that, I mean, I would I've played around with it a little bit. I would tweak it. Like, okay, if I'm walking faster, can I still do it? Not really. If I'm walking slower, can I still do it? Not really. It's just that there was this one pace that I had successfully tossed up the ball and caught the ball behind my back, and I could kind of reproduce it. Like, not every time, but, like, probably 2 out of 3 times, I tossed the ball up, I could catch it. And that, I think, is kind of more what we do, is we have these sorts of this, there's this mixture going on there. There's this sort of learning that's happening. There's this whole dynamic sense of our bodies and where they are and where objects are that has this sort of representation in us. And we can reproduce things that we do. And that's why I like the people who do, who are amazing batters in baseball. I mean, it's incredible that somebody's throwing this little thing very fast, and they're very skilled at placing it different places and making it move as it's coming towards you, and all of that stuff is happening. And you have this cylinder that you're going to try to get to come in contact with that at the right trajectory, at the right time. I mean, it's incredible that you can do that well. I mean, and when people take batting practice and it's just a consistent fastball down the middle, then my God, they're like, they can just hit home run after home run a lot. Some of these people can. And they're certainly not computing anything there. They're not computing a trajectory there. There's just like a few visual cues that they're taking, and there's like a path that their body goes through, and it manages to get them close enough each time to make something good happen most of the time. From my perspective, a lot of the, at least the spatial things that we do, the way we move our bodies around, I don't think there's a lot of computation necessarily happening in those. And in fact, you hear if you've ever played sports, you've heard a coach say something like, you're thinking about it too much.
Yeah.
And it does happen. Like, we try to, we're like, okay, I want to, like, keep my elbow here, and I want to, if you start doing that, you can try and practice to try to think about those a little bit, but once you're playing, you gotta let all of that thinking go. You just have to let your body react to things. Awesome. And, sorry? Muscle memory, people call it, yeah. Like, it's like it your body sort of gets this path that gets sort of a furrow in it, or it's a rut where it kind of executes the same thing smoothly, and it gets honed through practice. And then we can kind of forget it to an extent, but I mean, then there's the idea of like riding a bike, like you picking it up. Like, I haven't ridden a bike in probably a year. But I'm very confident that if I got on a bike, he'd totally do that again. So there are some things that we can kind of go back to, other things that we can't. Although, I can still spin a basketball on my finger. And I will admit, that took a lot of practice. That took me a long time to get that right. But now it's like, it's really easy. Still, to this day, I can pick up a basketball and spin it on my finger, and it's not hard. I don't know exactly how we learn it, but it feels a lot unlike computing to me. So, I don't know. There's a lot of feedback that's happening. So it's not like it's totally just blind. It's feedback that's happening. Like, you're adjusting where your finger is. But it's based on these little, like, micro cues. And, yeah. Right.
Same thing with muscle memory. If you need to do something, your body just reacts.
Right.
You program the muscle.
Right. You program it.
You refine it, and that'd be like your PID control. The better you get it, your controller, the better it makes the motion you want. And it takes time and practice.
Unless you suck at that stuff.
I've fallen asleep.
Yeah, I don't know. I disagree with that. So, like.
Really?
Yeah.
Photographic memory.
That's cool. Okay, but yes.
Babies can swim.
But like, okay, if we're going to fast twitch stuff, like that's called fast twitch muscle fiber.
Right.
I did Taekwondo for several years.
Right, but
I guarantee that
if a robot doesn't have a camera, then it's not going
to
use visual cues. If you don't have the ability to hit a speed
ball, they're
never
going to be able to do it. Just because you train something doesn't mean magic.
Right, that's what I'm saying. If a robot doesn't have sonar, it's not going to use sonar to attract something. If you don't have the ability to hit a speeding baseball, you're not going to be able to do it.
But does our brain still see that information? I mean, so how does a person...
It's hard to say.
So then what I'm wondering is it black and white? Do you have that ability or you don't have that ability?
It's hard to say. Sports science says yes, either you have that ability or you don't. Because you look at these sports science shows where guys are hitting buttons that light up, and they can hit them four or five times faster than somebody that doesn't have that ability.
Yeah.
It's probably not a yes or no. It's probably a gradient. Some people are really good at it.
Yeah.
Some people are slightly worse. Some people are terrible at it. But my wife can't be mad. Good at it, or you're not.
Yeah. There are a lot of things, and there's still. I mean, we're still learning about how we're able to learn a skill, and. There's research being done even right here in this lab. So you may have seen that Emily Coyle PhD sign there. That little miniature lab is a group from the psychology department, and they're doing research on how the toys that we give our kids affect their ability to do spatial reasoning and that type of thing. And the evidence so far has suggested that one of the reasons why women struggle with spatial reasoning when they get to be a certain age more than men do is because of the types of toys that they played with when they were young, which is very interesting. I mean, and so like the things that you played with when you were young affect your ability later on to do something or not, so to be able to think in a certain way or not. And so it's, I think it's really a big open question. And for robots, what does that mean for how we program them? Like, so if we want something to be able to react a certain way, is there a sort of training that they have to go through? And does it need to be a certain way?
Do you really want to put a child leash on your robot?
Yeah.
So you're suggesting like a development phase for the robot to go through?
Mm-hmm.
Theoretically.
Yeah, and they're already doing this to some extent. Yeah, that's so learning is actually one of the big areas in robotics is some sort of learning algorithm, often neural networks of some sort.
That makes a lot of sense psychologically because that's what every human goes through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's why, I mean, so neural nets are really cool. I mean, there was some hope for a while that they were going to solve all of our AI problems, and they have helped a lot. But it has its own limitations. Maybe we'll get to talk more about neural nets later. I think it's later on in this book. But yeah, it's... it's one of those things, when you have anything that learns, it can learn something the wrong way, or maybe it can learn something in a way that later is not helpful or not applicable, and so being able to relearn is important. So being able to remember is important, being able to forget is also important, which is weird, but it's true. I mean, it's kind of like in the most basic sense. Remember the PID controller that I showed last week, and we had the guy hold it to the side for a minute, and that integral wind-up happened, and it went whew. And the problem is that the thing has this memory that was actually hurting it. I mean, its memory usually helps it. The fact that it knows that it's had an error for a while is usually a good thing, but it can also be a bad thing. And the same is true in, I think it's simplistic to look at a human quite this way, but if you look at the psychological aspects in humans, we can have trauma that will affect us for a long time that really shapes us. And maybe we would be happier, healthier people if we didn't have that sort of psychological memory that we have. I don't know.
It's kind of like clowns for some people.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and there are some phobias that, you know, they have some roots that psychologists think in some, you know, really remote part of your past. Like when you were maybe even an infant or you were a toddler and you had some experience and now you're like afraid to go outside of your house. You have like agoraphobia or something. And that kind of stuff, it can be really destructive to ourselves. So that sort of memory, it's not necessarily memory in the way that we think of like a memory, but it's a different sort of memory where some event has had ripple effects through your life. And yeah, so it's not to say that forgetting is the answer either. Has anybody seen Eternal Sunshine of a Spotless Mind?
Yes.
Yeah. We should watch that movie. That would be so fun. I haven't seen that forever. Okay, we got to move on. Reactive control. We've touched on it a little bit. It's control that tightly couples sensing and affecting. It does not plan ahead. It is very fast. It is the most common control method in robotics. It's similar to reflexes. Okay? So action selection is the process of deciding among multiple possible actions or behaviors. This is a big problem in robotics. There are two basic types. There's arbitration, where we select one possible action from some possibilities. And then there's fusion, where you say, okay, well, these are two possibilities. Maybe they are two best candidates. Maybe we can fuse them somehow. That doesn't always make sense, but sometimes a fusion does make sense, and sometimes that can yield better results. Reactive controllers must be able to multitask. For example, they must be able to monitor sensor inputs and make other computations simultaneously in parallel. One of the most popular reactive architectures is the subsumption architecture. This architecture is modular with a hierarchy among the modules, which are suggestively called layers. Okay, so you have layers in your hierarchy of the modules. Each layer performs some task. For instance, avoid objects could be a layer. Each layer is largely independent of other layers, allowing each to be designed and debugged separately. Higher layers can, under certain conditions, subsume aspects of lower layers. This subsumption can occur by either suppressing the inputs or inhibiting the outputs of that layer. So you could say, okay, I'm not going to let this layer that's three layers below me do what it's going to do. I know better, and I'm going to do something different. So you can either do that by not letting that layer see the inputs or not letting the outputs be enacted. Complexity is added incrementally with each new layer, which helps the designer. This is called bottom-up design. This bottom-up design method is actually intentionally modeled off of evolutionary theories. So you want to start out with something simple, and then if you add this layer on top of it, you can add a little bit more complexity, which is kind of how, I mean, in an analogous way to how it's not really how natural selection works, but it's because there's nobody in natural selection saying this one. But what it does do is it allows you to add complexity into your design as you go, which is kind of how an organism evolves as well. It starts off more simple. First, it learns to absorb energy, and then it learns to seek energy, and then it learns to move around better in different modes, in different environments, survive in these conditions, and et cetera, et cetera. So they evolve towards more and more complexity. Yeah. the world is its own best model, is what they say, some robot designers say. So no internal model is used, no sequencing of tasks between layers is used. They're all running parallel all the time, which is really simple. They're all running, they're all ready to go, and so when something has, you know, an input and it senses something and it has an action it wants to take, it just does it. It doesn't have to go to arbitration, anything like that. Yeah.
So from a hardware level, how does that work with a like a multiprocessor? Because how do multiprocessors do things in parallel?
So you could have just different processors. So
yeah, so is it like a multiprocessor for each action?
Yeah, so you could have, for each layer, you could have your own, it could have its own microprocessor, even if you even needed it. Maybe some of them could just be totally analog, because a lot of them are really simple. A lot of them are, here's the sensor input, here's what I'm going to respond with, here's what my, you know, I'm going to use this actuator and do this. But if you have this subsumption that happens, you do have to be able to control a lower one from a higher one. And so you do have to have at least communication in there. So I think that it would be more typical to do a multi-threaded processor so that you could have multiple parallel processes happening. And then just say, okay, if there ends up we have like 15 sensors go off at the same time, and we have a little bit of a delay waiting for, you know, the queue to queue up the action. Yeah.
So if the higher layers can occasionally override the lower layers, can those be like nested? Like, can one processor control both layers?
Yeah. So. You could, but I think that the idea with this is that you want to get as close as possible to sensor input and actuator effector response. And so you don't want to have too much happening at the processor level with multiple levels being computed on the same processor. You might end up with lag happening there. It just depends on the time scales that you're working with. Sometimes you can get away with, you know, a few microseconds here and there, and it's not a big deal. Sometimes you can't, and you really need to be doing everything completely in parallel. For most applications, you can have a little bit of a queuing process for the. So it's not the reflex might be a little slow. I mean, we're not as quick at reacting. So even our so-called what are those reactions that we have sort of automatically? What are those?
Reflexes.
Thank you. Our reflexes can be slower or faster depending on what else is going on. So we could be distracted with something, and our reflexes aren't as good. As if we were sort of alert and ready, our reflexes are actually better. So this is similar. So yeah, these are all supposed to be kind of like reflexes, but maybe if you have a lot going on, you won't be quite as reactive to the situation. And our control system that we're working with is, for the project, is going to be largely a reactive controller. I mean, it isn't a system that has a lot going on with it, so it coming up with a control architecture is more straightforward. It's like, okay, yeah, well, we're going to sense something and we're going to react to it. But we do have a really short amount of time to deal with things. So we might have to think about, you know, can we wait for the processor to go through this? Do we even need to use analog circuitry to do this? Maybe we just need to do that. Maybe we can't even go through a microprocessor. Maybe it's too slow. We do have an FPGA, which is like super fast. So maybe we could do that. That one would be fun. But the people who are going to be programming that might not have as much fun. It is really fun. It's just, it's just a whole new world. It's just different.
There's an FPGAs for Dummies book.
There you go.
It's written especially for the acquisition by Intel.
That's funny.
And they bought Altera.
Yeah? So did they just, pay somebody?
Altera actually sponsored that book being written. So there's an official for Dummies book on FPGAs.
That's cool.
All Intel employees got a free copy.
That's cool. Okay, so drawbacks to reactive control. It has no or has minimal state representation, so it doesn't really have much representation at all, no internal representation of the world either. So that can be a big limitation. I think that we could all agree that at a certain level of intelligence, there's a need for some deliberation and something along those lines, and that that we're never going to get all the way to intelligent machines at the level of intelligence that we think at without some sort of deliberative control in it. But it doesn't necessarily mean it has to be all deliberative either. So it doesn't have any memory. And it doesn't learn. I mean, these things don't learn. I mean, you can add a layer of it on top that is a learning algorithm, but just based on the description that we have here, it just does these things. And it doesn't learn to do new things. It's just always, if bump sensor, do motor, or whatever. Then it's not learning. You have to have some sort of learning model on top of it if you're going to have it learn. So here's some seminar seeds. So this type of control often requires some sort of emergence to happen, right? Because we're just doing really simple programming, real simple logic for the most part. So how does this differ then from deliberative control? I think there are a lot of differences there. Especially to do with the emergence, though. What is it about? What is it about this way of doing control that requires some sort of emergence to happen? So, a bump sensor, motor on, great, not super complicated. That doesn't mean you're going to do anything useful with it, right?
It's hard or impossible to plan the outcome, actually.
Yeah, I mean, you can kind of have an intuition for what's going to happen. And you can do some basic design, but it's very hard to look to where you want to be and come up with a plan for how to write this reactive control stuff. So
is that the idea that you're thing, though, is that it's something that we saw that happened, just happened to happen, was happenstance that, yes, this happened to be what we wanted to happen, or it just happened, it wasn't something you necessarily desired, but you just did.
Yeah, so a lot of times it's found by accident. So yeah, it's something that is something that we often discover by accident, which is not a very good way to design something by accident, right? So, but for basic systems, we can design it to an extent, right? We can come up with a plan and say, okay, I think if I have something, I sense something on the left side, then if I turn the other way, then that'll, maybe that'll keep me near a wall or whatever. That sort of thinking, we can go through that a little bit in our minds as far as this action should, even if it's a really simple response, this should result in an emergent design that does something that we want. But when it gets more complex than that, it gets hard. It gets hard to really design them. And that's why, at this point, it's almost like voodoo, making emergent systems is kind of... It's like people have this inspiration. They're like, yes, I can do this and that, and then I have an emergent system, and then it works, or maybe it doesn't, but... that's kind of how it goes right now. I'm actually interested in trying to better systematize this process of designing emergent systems. I think it's hard to do.
Did you see the Super Bowl at all?
I did.
Specifically the halftime show where they use drones?
I did not. But I heard that they use drones. Was
so,
it pretty cool?
I think it was Intel actually sponsored for hundreds of drones to go up, and they were moving around in swarms to create different shapes, and they were lighting up in the correct colors. So they did the American flag, Intel symbol, a bunch of other stuff.
Wow.
It was interesting because I was thinking, is that just a display or whatever? But I was like, no, it's San Diego's in the background. How the hell are they doing this?
Wow.
Intel is currently like the only company in the world, or in the country, that's licensed to fly have a single pilot fly more than one drone at a time. So they had one person piloting all of those drones.
So they weren't using any kind of swarm control.
The controller is a little different than what you're used to.
But it was interesting to watch them move around, not intersect, hit each other. They were sometimes like drifting close to each other, but they would just move and then just.
Those drones are extremely light too. They're like 150 grams.
So you guys could build some drones like that. We could do cool stuff. I know some of you guys. Some of you guys have some drones, right? Blake? Yeah?
Just got
with
them yesterday.
Nice. That's cool.
There should be a smashed one around here somewhere. Yeah. The past senior design project. They broke it in competition.
I vowed long ago not to work on things that required flight to work.
Well, it was part of the ASME student design competition, I think it was 3 years ago.
I did a drone for my senior design project.
They had to deliver a payload. It was terrible. And they dropped the payload, and the drone went zoom, and then crashed into a hill.
Nice. Yeah, I'm really good at that last part. No, I mean, it's actually a lot better now, because you can get cheap gyro everything on like a little board that costs $20, which is awesome.
How come you won't put shed flight?
It's not really like it's more of a guideline. I don't want to have anything to do with making the thing fly, because I learned a lot about aero stuff while I was doing that project. And what I discovered is that I don't like it that much. Like the stability of the aircraft and all that stuff. Like, I mean, it's kind of cool, but I feel like the field is really kind of owned by people who are sort of like long-term people who kind of have intuition for how things should be laid out and what kind of vertical surfaces you need for stability and all of that. And it just didn't feel like the kind of thing I wanted to do. So I don't care. If somebody wants me to work on something that's already flying, cool. I'm down. But I don't want to make it fly. Like, that should
not
be part of
it. Hovercraft in this car?
Sorry?
We're not building a hovercraft in this class?
No, unless somebody already has a hovercraft they want to do something with. Because, yeah. So, okay. Is it possible for human-like intelligence to emerge from this type of control? We kind of hit on that a little bit, but...
Reactive
control.
From purely reactive control?
Mm-hmm. I don't think so. I mean, that's my personal opinion, but... And I'll justify why I think so, because I think that we use symbols to do things and to plan and to make decisions. We don't always use these things, but we do. And I think it's one of the essential aspects of humanity is that we use these symbols and deliberation and all that planning. And I think that without that aspect, we wouldn't be able to create anything that was like like us, I guess.
You've mentioned intuition a couple times.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's capable or if a machine is capable of having intuition.
I don't know. It's kind of an open question.
Well, I think you could have some self-preservation tendencies emerge.
Mm-hmm.
Which you consider human-like intelligence.
Intuition is sort of like building off of past mistakes in a way, right?
I mean, it's kind of, I mean, I would say that sometimes that's what it means. It means so learning is like learning from past mistakes, I think, is kind of what learning does.
I think it's the ability to create a more accurate model than somebody else, maybe. If you have better intuition, you have a more accurate model in your head than that other person. Right?
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of, it's understanding something without knowing how you understand it.
Yeah. I think that it's hard to define intuition, but my sense of it is that we're able to it's very close to the kind of concept of having a feel for something. And intuition is typically built off of having a lot of experience in an area. And so intuition, I think, comes from some sort of learning process. And I think it's inherently a fuzzy sort of, and I kind of mean that in the sense of fuzzy logic, and I kind of mean that in the sense of just murky, sort of fuzzy idea that this is the right way to go, or this is the best move here, or this is going to work out.
So this all sounds like building off of knowledge, what you're taught, and experience.
Yeah.
So it's sort of going back to the conversation about learning and development.
Mm-hmm.
Putting these artificial intelligences through a learning process.
Yeah. And they already have that to an extent. There are things that
so they
learn.
Capable of that because you can train, you can teach. The person who programs this bot would be able to instill that person's knowledge to this bot, right?
Mm-hmm.
Having that knowledge, then it would naturally have intuition about whatever's been taught, right?
Yeah, possibly. I mean, I guess there's, I think, like the tossing the ball up and catching it behind my back, I feel like that's a sort of, it's not dissimilar to intuition. Like, I have a sort of intuition about where that ball is going to be.
That is intuition, right?
Yeah, and like, I have no calculations to tell me that's where the ball is going to be. I've done this sometimes, and like, it feels like the path that leads to where the ball is. And I think that it's kind of like that. Like, I have, you know, maybe a detective has an intuition that this is the perpetrator.
So it's like, can the bot think to grab at that spot without running a calculation?
I think that with neural networks, they can. They can learn to do that.
Without running a calculation or anything? Because isn't that what...
So neural networks are a different type of calculation, but I guess I think that we have some sort of mechanism that does it.
Yeah.
And the mechanism, I think, is analogous to what a neural net does. I don't think that it is fully captured by neural nets, but neural nets are a step in the right direction as far as that sort of learning goes. And we'll talk. And what I'll do is remind me if I start to forget this. But I think I should do a lecture on neural nets at some point, because I think that would be really fun. You guys would probably like it. They're really cool. I mean, when you actually see them, they're kind of simpler than they sound. They sound like super complex, but they're kind of cool, and you can do really cool stuff with them. And you could build them into like you guys could write a program that does a neural net calculation. So, yeah. Yeah, there are toolboxes in Python that can do it. There's a MATLAB toolbox that does it. Anyways, we better move on. Neural nets are cool, though. Maybe we should talk more about them. Hybrid control does what you would think. You have a little bit of both happening. You've got this deliberative side going, calculating where to go. You got this reactive side that's just like reflexes. And it's nice because you have the reflexes happening quickly, so you're ready to respond. But then the deliberation can help you plan and do those things, which are, you know, obviously helpful if you can do them. Hybrid controllers use three layers or modules. They're not the same layers and modules as in the reactive controller, but we still use the same terminology because terminology. There's a reactive layer, a planning layer, and a layer that links them. And that's the thing that's hard, is linking the two layers together. So how do you have planning happening and reactive happening? How do you do the arbitration of what to do? This comes up a lot, actually, in robotics. It's not just in hybrid control, though. If you have a robot that is in an uncertain environment, doesn't know what it should do, it has a certain confidence level at each point, like that what it's doing is correct. It's actually computing these ones that I'm thinking of. They're developing some robots that go inside of a certain company's airplane wings, and they need to drill holes in places or put a bolt there or whatever, because it's hard to get in these things because they're not that thick, a lot of stuff in them. So a robot crawls around and does something in there, has a certain confidence that what it's doing is correct, but if that confidence falls off at a certain point, like for instance, when it gets close to the hole it needs to put the bolt in or something, its ability to tell where that hole is gets harder and harder for it to specifically locate it, and so its confidence drops off. And then at some point it wants to actually kick control over to a human to teleoperate it and finish the task. And the human can also kick control back to the bot. And there's this, you know, how do you arbitrate that? How does it know when to kick its control over to the human? How does the human know? And also, should the human be able to refuse control? What should happen if neither wants control? there are some interesting questions that come up, but this arbitration is complicated as far as what the best move is sometimes. And that's similar with this, is you have reactive saying, you know, motor rev up in this direction, and you have the planning one saying, no, go the other direction, which one should you go with? You got to come up with an architecture that lets you know that. And so a lot of it becomes very ad hoc, and it becomes very, very application specific, right? You can't just like come up with a general linking layer that just works for all cases. So that's why it's not a very easy to use way of doing control. So the middle layer compensates for the limitations of the other two, reconciles their disparate timescales, reconciles their different representations, and reconciles contradictory commands. So it's got to do all of that. So it's hard to design them. You can deal with changes in the environment by having the reactive layer inform the deliberative layer when it encounters obstacles, which is a good start. If it was a totally deliberative machine, it might not have even been able to recognize that there was an object there because it was calculating about what the next move was. But the reactive layer is like, hey, your plan isn't working out, so I feel like the reactive controller is kind of like a little bit sarcastic. And like, you told me to go here, but it didn't work out. So that kind of thing. Good. A hybrid controller can try to balance the need to plan and replan with immediate needs. Sometimes a rough plan now is more valuable than a full plan later. Some plans recur often, and so it's useful to store them and look up table for fast retrieval. Of course, that's only true if your environment's not changing very rapidly. They're difficult to design and debug. The middle layer, you know, specialized to a specific problem or robot, and sometimes they work to the detriment of each other. Sometimes a reactive control robot, when you put on a deliberative layer on it, it can actually perform worse than it did before when it just had reactive. So, I mean, it may be in certain circumstances, not in all circumstances, hopefully, otherwise it would not make any sense to use it. Okay, we're going to just power through here because behavior-based is the last one. Behavior-based control uses behaviors as modules or layers of its architecture. Behaviors achieve and or maintain goals. They're time extended. They don't happen instantaneously. They take inputs from sensors and other behaviors. They send outputs to effectors and other behaviors. They're more complex than actions. So simple reactive control has actions, and behavior-based control has behaviors. So whereas a wall-following robot could be a reactive robot that's following a wall, you could also have that be a behavior in a behavior-based controlled robot. So you could say, follow a wall could be a behavior that you're telling it to go do. So go follow the wall. You might even implement that with just reactive control because it's a nice way to go with it. But you would be the controller would not just be unaware of the fact that it's following a wall. It would say, follow a wall. Principles of good BBC or behavior-based control design. Behaviors can be executed in parallel. Okay, so that is not always possible, but ideal if you can make it happen. Networks of behaviors can be used to store, state, and construct representations, and behaviors can operate on similar timescales. Okay. This is still this is very research, this sort of control. A lot of robotics is pretty researchy, but this is a particularly researchy area. I think that the author of the textbook does research on this. That's part of why it's in here. Key properties is that you have real-time reaction, an ability to use representations, an ability to use a single structure in its architecture, so no hybridization. And other control architectures, so BBC and other control architectures don't necessarily have an aspect to them that explicitly details how to perform behaviors the robot may still exhibit through the interaction of its modules. Those behaviors are called emergent behaviors. So say you had a behavior program, like follow a wall. There's an emergent behavior that you can do with a swarm of robots that like arranges the whole swarm in a certain shape, and you can create them by having each robot follow edges to a certain point and like reach a threshold and then stop. And then the next, so you'll see them like all rearranging themselves by following the outside edge. And that's an emergent behavior that is probably behavior based, and it's probably programmed in to like follow the edge of the cluster. So you could think of there are sort of layers to the emergence here then, because there's emergence in the sense that you could do wall following with really simple reactive control, and then you can do this sort of what do they call it, formation or something like that, self-formation. Sorry?
It's not flocking.
Well, it's similar to flocking, but flocking is something that you think of typically more as they're all moving together, and they're moving together with a certain, you know, sort of equidistance among them. I forget what they call it. There's a name for reshaping the whole group. And so you can do it by just like having this, I mean, they have these little cheap robots that they build, and they're, you know, they have like 1,000 of them or some ridiculous number. They had an army of students building those, I bet.
So there's a program now, because that's an old MIT project,
mm-hmm.
and you can buy 1,024 robots as a part of a kit now from the little like company that
spooled off of that.
Yeah,
that's cool.
It's like $50 a robot, though. It's pretty expensive.
$50 a robot?
Yeah. I looked into it.
Jeez. What's on board?
It's got some of those vibratory motors.
Yeah.
I don't remember how the control exactly works, but the controller, obviously.
Yeah.
You know, they're about that big.
Yeah. Yeah. Whoa. Seems like you could do better than $50 a pop. Is that the cheapest one out there to get mass?
I think it's actually like if you buy 100, it's $50. You buy 1,000, it's like 25 or something like that. It's still a lot.
Yeah. Dang. Yeah. I have a couple mobile robots that are not the little swarm version, but two that should be able to interact though. That I've got on order. Well, the order will be in soon. I have a quote, and hopefully the funds will be dispersed to get an order soon. So you guys might be able to play around with them by the end of the semester. Hopefully, it should be pretty cool. Good. So that was all I have for the seminar section. Is there anybody who had any other comments?
I had a comment actually. As I was reading through these sections, I kept thinking of a Flatland story. It's like Edwin Abbott. You guys know what that's all about. And so I think when we keep like harkening back to human behavior and the human perspective towards likening it to robots, it's actually detrimental to designing robots, or it can be at least, or it can just be counterproductive. Because when I was actually looking, you know, reading that story and looking at that, I kept thinking of the 3D perspective of that. And of course, that's the 2D perspective, actually the 1D perspective of what their view is they're just looking at lines, right? They're not looking at these 2D shapes. And so we gotta do the exact same thing when we're designing robots, is really try to put yourself in perspective of the sensory input. And then, you start to be able to make the decisions that robot could make based on those sensory input. And they're like super rudimentary, right? So it's really easy to fall into a trap, I think, of, well, why isn't it doing this? It's obvious that this can is blocking the way of the robot. You know?
Right. Yeah, I think it is hard to get in that mindset where we forget about, you know, I think that what I find useful about thinking back to the human perspective is that why do we think it's so easy? You know, and maybe there's some mechanism that we use that we could help design a robot with. And maybe it's not. Maybe it's super complicated and maybe it's not easy to do. But I think that our internal experience of the world is very useful as a guide to overcoming obstacles when we're designing robots. But I think that when we're looking at their performance, we should definitely try to avoid being too harsh on them from the human perspective, because I mean we have a lot of advantage over these robots, and our sensory input is something that robots aren't even in the same ballpark at. Like, they have so much less information to work with than we do. So it's hard to keep that perspective. For instance, like when we lean against something, like we know a lot about that thing just based on how it feels against our skin and all kinds of stuff. Which the robot probably has no sensors to tell it that stuff.
Or like a one-dimensional input, right? I mean, that's
right. Yeah. What did you guys? So, what were some of the, what were some of the things that you guys researched? So maybe like we could go around and everybody could tell us kind of what their topic was that they researched, and just tell us a little bit about what you learned. Do you want to start, John?
So my research topic was on swarming, and I ended up researching the ant colony optimization method. It's a complex algorithm derived about 15 years ago, specifically for imitating ants to perform search operations. And that has been pretty much like the most commonly used search function for the better part of the last decade, although more recently it's been replaced with the glowworm or firefly algorithm.
So how does it work?
It basically it uses the pheromone trails and imitates that with a time, like inverse time dissipation.
Yeah. So it has like little.
It's like the closer locations have stronger trails.
Right. That's cool. That was my understanding too of it.
And the firefly algorithm goes. It uses like hereditary traits between variables. So it more seeks out what it's looking for rather than just following.
Okay. Interesting. So it's so fireflies can also find like they like swarm to a food source or something like that.
It has more to do with mating.
Okay. So they're trying to find a mate.
And desirable traits, which
okay.
Be hereditary.
Interesting.
They're going to be like different intensities of their bioluminescence,
okay.
Which attracts mates and that kind of thing.
Interesting. Well, I look forward to reading it. Cool. How about you, sir?
So I research on base control, but a different architecture. I was looking at this architecture. It's like IB2C.
Okay.
Architecture.
I've heard
so
of
how that. It groups like different modules of different behaviors together to perform some action and like to give it more like a real time response. So it's kind of like a little bit of a complicated read because they have some formulas in there. It's like I don't. Yeah, they did some tests on it, but.
Huh. Were they instantiating it in actual robots, or was it just simulation? Do you remember?
They did like a test on, I forgot the name of the robot is. They did a little test, like a sip. They did a low level test, though, not like something super complicated. But like a low level, like avoiding obstacles kind of test. But yeah.
That's cool. Nice.
I didn't really get around to researching, but I was very interested in the reactive control chapter. I liked. I wanted to see how far you could take that. I'd be interested to see how far you could take string a bunch of reactions together and make some sort of, like they were talking at the end of the chapter, some sort of emergent behavior just based on reactions and how things pop up. So.
Yeah. So something that they didn't talk about much is that you can actually take a metric and do artificial evolution, which I think is one of the coolest things. That so like with a design, so you could do, you could say, okay, say you have these sensory inputs, like do this or do that, and then based on some metric, choose your best candidate, and then evolve it forward by doing some sort of random mutations and choose the best one from that and then evolve that one forward and get these different designs. They do this with soft robotics, actually. It's kind of interesting. It's pretty cool. They make these things that can sort of gallop across by just learning that when you used...
Yeah, I've seen that. There's like on there's a computer program, so it's not an actual robot.
Right. At this point, it's just in simulation.
And it's simulations, but it's just make these appendages and see if you can move forward. And if this, you do a bunch of iterations and whichever design goes furthest, iterate on that one and iterate on that one, and you end up getting something that like walks or wobbles or hobbles.
Yeah.
But just based on reactions and, like you said, a metric.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I mean, it's essentially like doing evolution in simulation. And there are some people, I consider them to be radical, who believe that the era of engineers designing things is coming to a close, and that there will be evolutionary design is going to take over. And what we're going to do is we're going to say, you know what, we want this thing. It'll be all about defining what we want. And then we'll just let the algorithms design it. And then it's going to spit us out some candidates. And then we'll use those designs. I don't foresee that happening anytime in the near future. But I do think that the idea of using evolution in the design process is very interesting. And I'm interested to try to formalize that a little bit more and try to come up with a design process that you could follow with and you could use the evolutionary leaps but guide it yourself as you go. So I don't know. I think that there could be some cool stuff. You could kind of make like designing something into like a video game of sorts. It could be cool. I think it would be really neat. So, because we all want to just for our jobs just be playing video games. So, we've all had that fantasy at some point. And so, maybe my career is just heading towards making Twitch all of engineering streamer into a video game. Yeah.
They talked about some of the other behavior stuff and how some of the other hybrid controls. And they talked about, oh, we use fuzzy logic. They don't really explain what it is and how it works.
I have a good textbook to introduce you to that.
That's not a little bit light reading for tonight.
Yeah. but like the first chapter would get you most of the way to. I mean, fuzzy logic is really pretty straightforward. Actually, it just sounds scary. Pretty much the whole idea is that, you know how in traditional logic, something either is true or is not true? So either an element is a member of a set or it's not a member of a set. That goes away in fuzzy logic, and same with fuzzy set theory, which is based on that. So you can be a member of a set to a certain degree. So, for instance, you could be warm to a certain degree.
Some people research that, you know, you're
kind of
spoiling.
Sorry. Oh, man. Okay. I'll let you go do that. But anyways, fuzzy logic, if fuzzy set theory is super cool. May or may not have time in this class for me to lecture on that, too. But, yeah. Scott.
Well, I'm starting to go into the behavior-based control and came across that article on the computer that plays poker and looked at the architecture behind how they program them.
That's cool. So did they talk about like any people who have been trying to use this as
no,
to, like the
no,
game
this,
system
this, just, this just happened in January and it's just brand new.
Yeah.
But no, they're just talking about how it they pre-program the, you know, it's the strategy, and then while it's playing the game, it continues to refine the strategy, and then afterwards, it in the background, it continually runs a program to better its strategy.
And this is, it's learning the players it's playing against.
Yeah, it was. Yes. I think it was in a tournament setting. It wasn't just a single game.
That's cool.
Yeah, it was a 20-day tournament.
Yeah, because it's interesting, because you can play poker intelligently based on what cards have been shown.
You'll lose against the pros doing that.
Right. Well, but there's the other element of it where you have learning of a certain person's. Well, I mean, sometimes people talk about like being able to tell by their body language, stuff like that. I don't know how much of that is true, but there probably is some amount of it. But then there's learning how they play, though. Like, are they willing to go all the way to the end and get called on a bluff, or are they going to jump out before so that they don't get revealed? That type of thing.
Right, and that's what the guy was saying. He didn't program the ability to bluff into the program. It was just the computer came up with the strategy to beat the person, and bluffing was part of it.
Wow.
So the computer taught itself a lie.
Yeah. We're screwed.
I looked into the soft robotics that you were talking about.
Yeah.
And I think in your office, you were talking a little while ago about the muscles that you could twist with a fishing line.
Mm-hmm.
I looked into that a little more, but I found another study done at Harvard, and they're using fluids to try to simulate muscle movement. So this is a little video of what they came up with. Not a video, just a little graphic. And basically, they're trying to mimic hand movements. So they have one that can do a thumb, like this guy here, and then obviously this one here. And they said one of the main problems with trying to mimic the hand is we don't just have one actuator that goes like this. There's a lot of different movements we can do. So that's one of the difficulties they're trying to figure out with this fluid system. Is making more actuators from different areas, basically. It's like from different directions, so you can make your fingers go different directions.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we have these amazing, these muscles are really cool, and they allow you to do lots of movements that are hard to replicate mechanically. I mean, they really are. I mean, the fluid stuff is really neat. Oh, yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
The fluid stuff is really neat, and I think that, you know, in soft robotics, a lot of times fluids are used because they're soft, and you can do actuation with them. But, yeah.
It didn't look like it could hold very much weight, though.
That's one of the big problems with soft robotics. It's also its own weight can be a challenge, too, because you start moving the fluid around, and suddenly its own weight distribution is hard to fight against. So, yeah, because it's soft and it isn't rigid. But now, I mean, people are starting to think about in terms of skeletons in soft robotics. So, like, you could have a stiff, like we have a stiff skeleton, and then we have these soft bodies on top of that. And so a mixture of the two seems like it will be productive area.
Not just a worm.
Sorry?
Not just like a worm.
Right.
I think that's what these guys have. Looks more like a worm.
Yeah. And they've made some pretty cool like snake robots and stuff like that they've made that are flexible.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They're pretty cool. But those soft ones are really great for grasping small light things, at least.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wrote up on artificial intelligence, and it kind of touched on like deep learning a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So you just feed a machine mountains of data, and it sifts through it and picks up relevant stuff. Interesting quote from the CEO of NVIDIA said that in the past year or 2 years, artificial intelligence has changed from a research field to an engineering application. There's actually, I didn't know this, but there's like an AI arms race going on right now. Like Google and Microsoft are working together. Intel just bought two AI companies for like $700 million. There's like a Chinese university just programmed their AI to take an IQ test and it beat a post-grad. They got a higher score than them. So there's a lot more to AI than weapons.
Yeah.
It's gotten a pretty good industrial and commercial application.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are becoming more and more of them, and yeah, people are starting to use it to solve lots of different types of problems. And it comes down to how to optimize things lots of times, what the AI can do to optimize something, and it's pretty cool stuff. It's a pretty hot area.
I still don't really know how deep learning works, but I get the broad strokes.
Yeah. You could use deep learning techniques to find out.
Pattern recognition.
Yeah, that's about as far as I got.
Yeah, cool.
I wasn't able to research anything specific, but there have been a few things I am very interested in. And one is the idea of robots learning right now. It's very conceptual in my mind right now because I still don't fully get it, I don't think.
Mm-hmm.
To robotics, how to do that. Also the differences between, you know, we use a set amount of sensors all the time, which is how we know our surroundings, and then it's through learning that we understand that when we lean against the wall, that's what we're leaning against. It's like bringing that intrinsic knowledge to a machine that usually just runs calculations. How do we get past that?
Yeah.
That's the big thing. The other thing is derivative control in those motors. You should do last year. That's really cool. Manageable control.
Yeah. Well, I think that I got to get that demo working because you guys will be able to play with it. We essentially built what I think is a cooler version of that last year. So you get to have a little hands-on experience with it. And then in the project, we might use that kind of control possibly. Yeah, PID.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, we got to get to the sketches here. So, yeah. Neil?
I researched behavior control, and it ended up going into social robots, robots that were able to learn and teach humans.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a field that's evolved from basically swarm technology application to a robot that can now see, hear, talk and react to its environment. And the one I found was Leonardo. It's from MIT. It's basically a Furby from hell.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually very creepy because it was programmed to replicate human interaction. So it would do things like dart its eyes around at the end of sentences and conversations to train people to keep the conversation flowing, rather than having awkward pauses because the robot wouldn't know what to do with just this long pause. So I thought that was pretty interesting that it was training.
Wow.
It's,
Have you heard about Microsoft Tay? It's an AI that they launched last year. And it was a Twitter robot.
Is that the one that existed in like 30 minutes?
Nope. They had to shut it down immediately. It had like 100,000 followers. It's like, it was spamming messages on towards the end, average of once every 7 seconds, and it was just like super, super racist. And
you can't let the internet teach anything. You really just
and
can't.
It's supposed to be the personality of like a 16-year-old girl.
That's when you. I think they were actually.
So I looked into emergence more,
mm-hmm.
but from a non-robotics perspective. So, in a sense, they're claiming that emergence is in every facet of our lives,
mm-hmm.
from a philosophical perspective to a developmental perspective. What we mentioned before about a grayscale, that is a great example of what they believe is how the human mind works, is a grayscale. Anger is not the sense of anger. Anger could be the combination of different grayscales within our brain that create anger, and anger is an emergent attribute. So they dive deeper into that. I really started to look into hurricanes, and they And they now believe that the way that hurricanes grow is directly related to crystal lattices in water molecules. So there's an emergent pattern from a molecular structure to a grandiose hurricane. And then breaking down a hurricane of how they start to, you know, its pressure difference. Well, where's that pressure difference coming from? Next thing you know, you're five levels deep talking about something that's not related to a hurricane, but it creates an emergent pattern to create a hurricane.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, it's emergence is everywhere. It's, you can't get away from it once you see it, and once you see it, you can't not see it.
Yeah, it's really cool. Those of you who are really interested in emergence, I recommend considering looking up some work on chaos theory. Well, it's called a lot of things, but chaos theory is at the heart of a lot of these things. At least our current theoretical understanding of a lot of these things. And it's really cool. I mean, everything is a dynamic system in their perspective. And some of the ideas that you've learned about dynamic systems in your engineering classes are a big part of the way they think about this stuff. So it's pretty cool stuff. Yeah, I kind of want to do a directed study with somebody on chaos theory. I only know, like, you know, the basics of chaos theory, but it's pretty cool from what I've seen. So, yeah.
So yeah, I did the fuzzy logic thing, right? And just to be brief, now we're running out of time. So there's like three basic steps. First one they call fuzzification, and that takes some sort of like some sensory data that is incomplete or just not precise, and then it'll like basically put a significance gradient on it. So this might be like kind of 20% significant or 20% true, while this sensory data might be 8% true. And then the second step is inference. And inference applies these significant gradients into these certain categories. And then the third one is defuzzification. And that assesses what's in the category and then outputs like a crisp output that is actionable for the robot. So that's kind of like the basic fuzzy logic.
So it's like a weighted average?
It's kind of like that, but it really depends on how you're setting up your inference and also how, you know, the design is all in how you set up the inference and also the classifications, and there's different strategies that people come up with.
I also researched fuzzy logic.
Nice.
So you kind of said it all, but when I was thinking about it, naturally I came up with a food analogy. And it's like, if someone gave me a pizza, I would look at it and be like, okay, that's a pizza. But if I saw a pizza crust, I'd think that's a crust. But at what point did it turn from a pizza into a pizza crust? If you have a pizza crust with just like a little bit of sauce and cheese, is that a pizza? So it kind of like ranks to what degree it is, like you said, too. Is this part of that set or that set? And then using those kind of rankings of validity, it can rearrange your behavioral like hierarchy, especially in dynamic situations, and then it can act upon that. So.
Sweet.
And they use it, they've been using it for edge detection and visual images.
Mm-hmm.
And because sometimes the edges aren't so clear, so you have to kind of rank which edge should we start with. This one definitely looks like an edge, we'll start there and work our way down or something.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. Awesome.
This is covered in chapter 19 actually, but I researched SLAM, simultaneous localization and mapping. It's basically like robots, like I like finding out where they are locally and then also mapping out a path. There's a bunch of different ways they can do that, like through sensor types. And there were four main sensor types, like sensor system configurations. They started out like just metrics, like just the measurements, like a laser, dome laser, a 360-degree laser. basically just taking metrics. And something cool about this was that once you combine metrics and topological information, you could like imagine a robot just like going around a room, getting a bunch of data. You're like, okay, I don't know what this data necessarily represents. They can actually like calculate the data like a closed loop solution that basically it like fits the data to what they think it should look like. So I don't know, that's pretty cool. There's a bunch of information on it.
Cool. Awesome. Wow, there's some cool topics. Don't forget to upload your papers to the server, to the Moodle. And I am, I think we'll take a couple minute break and then come back, and we might stay a little longer than 4:30. But let's start back at like 2 till 4, and then we'll do the project stuff. We have a lot to cover in the project. I have a lot to talk about, and you guys do too. I think we finished the 1 hour lecture, yeah. Just now.